are several announcements. First of which is Wednesday we had our first midweek Lenten worship service at noon and at 7:15. And for the first time ever doing that, it went well. It's a beautiful worship service, so if you are free, come. Also, Hannah, why don't you come, or excuse me, Sarah, why don't you come and make your announcement? There should be children around handing out invitations to next week's children's Christmas program, so you're getting those announcements. Go ahead, Sarah.
I know last week I mentioned, so I'll mention it again, we are doing an instrumental ensemble for the youth in our church before Christmas Eve service. So if you have not talked to me and you have a kiddo maybe interested in doing that, I have music for you and we'll practice before. It's a group of kids, so it's kind of similar to a band. So just let me know if they're interested in that. Thanks.
Tracy?
Yes, I am making the announcement about the Children's Christmas program that Pastor Dan was talking about. If you did not get an invitation, please stop out front and pick one up. But the Children's Christmas program is next Saturday evening at 5:30. That's December 13th at 5:30. The children have been working very, 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 very hard over the last about 5 weeks to prepare for this Christmas program. So I hope that you can all be there. I think they're going to really do a great job.
Next Saturday morning, there will be Breakfast with Santa with an early opportunity for members of Messiah, and you should have received that big flyer. I'm sure you're all anxious to go and have breakfast with Santa, so you may avail yourself of that. Let's see, finally, our gospel text, we have a visit from John the Baptist, and as an introduction to who John the Baptist was, Mark has quoted Isaiah. So we're going to look at the prophet Isaiah as well as the gospel of Mark and John the Baptist. I think that is all I have for the announcements.
Let us pray. Almighty God, God of our Advent, God of our waiting, be with us. Help us to continually hear the voice of one crying in the wilderness, that we turn our lives around, that we repent and find you as you come as a baby and as you come as our eternal King. Stir up our hearts to prepare the way of your only Son. By his coming, strengthen us to serve you with purified lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please rise and sing as we prepare our hearts for worship.
Thank you.
we light the candle of peace, and it is a flame, as we light this flame, it is a flame that is the promise of God to be a light in our darkness, to be a promise that the light will come and enlighten our eyes. Let us pray. Source of light, shine in our lives and in our world with your everlasting peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray.
Living together in trust and hope, we proclaim our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, who created us and all we see and hope to see. We believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, whose coming we await with longing. Because he redeems us and shows us love, grace, and forgiveness. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Merciful and forgiving God, we confess that we continually miss the mark in our thinking, in our speaking, and in our actions. We leave things incomplete. We neglect our neighbors. We wait impatiently for the coming of Jesus, who comes as a gift to us. Fill us, help us to receive him. Help us share our gifts with all creation, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Both Advent and Christmas is about Almighty God coming to us, and he's anxious to come. Come and forgive and renew. So hear these words. For the sake of Jesus Christ, Almighty God does come. Forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Gospel lesson this morning comes from the Gospel of St. Mark, the first chapter. St. Mark writes, "The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah, 'See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make his paths straight.' John the baptizer appeared in the wilderness proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, 'The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit.'" The Gospel of the Lord. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Share God's peace by greeting those around you. All right, I'd like to invite the children to come forward. morning. How are you? Good. Well, today, can anybody read that sign up there? Zach. Messiah, very good. Street adopted by Dewey and Messiah Lutheran Church. Okay? Dewey, evidently, signed up, so we have a street we adopted. And when we adopt a street, don't we keep it clean? Well, John the Baptist is in our gospel lesson today telling us to keep the streets cleaned. Clean up the roads, and we'll see what that means for us, okay? So listen real careful.
Do, 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 do. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. Prepare ye the way of the Lord.
Hey, Dewey, what are you doing?
I'm cleaning my street.
Your street?
Yes.
How can that be your street?
Just read the sign, silly. See, it's my street. I adopted it.
Well, it still belongs to the city. You just adopted it so you can take care of it.
Same difference. Do you believe all this trash? People throw trash up and down my entire street.
Well, it was nice of you to adopt the street so you can pick up the garbage.
Oh, but I'm going to do more. I'm getting a bulldozer to straighten out the curves. I'm even taking down the stop signs.
Why would you do that?
Well, Jesus is coming.
Yeah, I know, but what does that have to do with the streets?
John the Baptist said in the Bible that we are to prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight.
Yeah?
That means garbage pickup and bulldozers. Clean up, straighten up, all the roads for Jesus.
Oh, really?
Yes, really. Now stand back. I need to keep working.
I think that to prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight, means something else. We are not to clean up our streets. We are to clean up our hearts.
Our hearts? Make roads in our hearts. Repent. Believe in Jesus.
That's right. Believe in Jesus.
What a way to prepare ye the way of the Lord. Prepare ye the way of the Lord.
That's all, folks.
So we prepare the way of the Lord. We prepare the way of the Lord by cleaning up our hearts, okay? And getting rid of all the trash so Jesus can come in, okay? Let us pray. Repeat after me. Gracious God, we thank you for John the Baptist, who tells us to repent. Help us to repent so Jesus can be born in our hearts. In his name we pray. Amen. All right, you may go back to your seats. probably don't want to have these little insights into my life, but I preached this sermon well last night, and it just doesn't, for some reason, every once in a while I peek at the beginning, not at the end. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. There's an internet prayer that comes around and around, and I'm sure all of you have read this prayer or encountered this prayer somewhere along the line. And it goes like this. So far today, God, I've done all right. I haven't gossiped. I haven't lost my temper, haven't been greedy, grumpy, nasty, selfish, overindulgent, or told anyone to mind their own business and to stay out of mine. I'm really glad about that, but in a few minutes, God, I'm going to get out of bed, and from then on, I'm going to need a whole lot of help. I'm sure you've read that prayer and maybe even relate to it, that I need a whole lot of help. God, please help. Well, in our Old Testament passage from Isaiah, we see that the people of Israel needed a whole lot of help. Things were happening to them that were not in their control. Ooh. Here's what was going on. And we've been through this before. You've heard me say this time and time again. The first 39 chapters of Isaiah happened to be written before they went into exile and maybe during part of the exile, and they have been lambasted by the prophet Isaiah. It is their fault. They have sinned. They have been unfaithful to God. Why have they been taken into exile? God was just angry. And now in the 39th chapter, a big change happens. They've been in exile for 50, some scholars believe as much as 70 years they have been in exile and away from Jerusalem and Israel. And now Isaiah chapter 40 begins with these words. Comfort, 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 oh, comfort my people, says our God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, and that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. So now they can return. Those words, comfort, comfort, oh, my people. Why? Because God Almighty is giving them permission now to return to Israel. Second part, a voice cries out, in the wilderness prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. So, there's two sermons there, if you noticed. Comfort, 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 oh, comfort my people. Their time in exile has ended. It's been a long time, and now you can go back. And most of the people going back will be people who have never been to Jerusalem or Israel. The only thing is the people can't go back on their own. They need help. The trip is long. If they went straight through as the crow flies, they'd have to go through the wilderness, through the desert. No water, up and down. It's going like taking a hike in the Ozark Mountains. If you've got all the brush and the forests to take care of, but you're up and down, and rock. No water, sun beating down. They can't go that way. And on top of it, so the only way they can go is to make the trip up to Syria and then down to Jerusalem and to Israel. But God says, don't worry, I've taken care of that. I have chosen Cyrus, the pagan military king. Cyrus is now your benefactor, and he will help make that trip possible. So they're tied up in problems that are not anything, there's nothing that they can do about it. But God Almighty is giving them tremendous promise. I will take care of your problems. By the way, don't you think most of our problems in life that really cause us anxiety and anger and pain happen to be things that we have no control over? We can't do anything about them. Even international problems. An American, British-born American, is held captive in Yemen. Twice we send a military rescue team. Second time, it failed in the sense that they didn't rescue him. He was killed. Things like that are out of our control. The wars are out of our control. Even within our country, the racial tension and division is out of our control. And our response to it, if it happens to be anxiety, and it tends to be anger. And we certainly saw anger up in Ferguson with the destruction. Well, the people of Israel felt they were out of control, and God's saying, comfort, comfort, O my people. Here's the good news. I have elected Cyrus to take care of you and get you back home. Then when they get back home, they have a whole different set of problems, but at least they're getting home. The second promise now, God says, a voice cries out. And who is that voice? They believe that voice represents an angelic being of some sort. Build in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Build this highway now through that wilderness that the people cannot travel through. But we're going to, and we understand this to be a metaphor, but a highway through the wilderness. And what do they call it? A royal highway. That God Almighty, the King, will come through the wilderness. Every valley will be lifted up and every mountain will be brought down, and it'll be paved, all the rocks and stones out of the way, so it will be this nice straight valley. Why? God Almighty himself wants to come to his people, and he's going to make, God's going to do it. The people have no control over it, but God's going to make a highway now back into their lives when they become a new nation. Now we jump to, God is saying, I want to come to you, and I will make that happen. God will build the highway. Now we jump to the New Testament, and John the Baptist picks up these words, or we could say the gospel writer Mark picks up these words, and he now says that voice is John the Baptist. And what does John the Baptist say? Prepare ye the way of the Lord, make paths straight. And when he starts shouting those words, repent, we understand the pathway that he wants to build is this pathway straight into our hearts. Prepare, because God is coming. And how is he coming? He's coming straight to you, to your heart. It's often when we are out of control. So John makes that road metaphor very personal for us. And John says, repent. Now, yesterday morning, I was listening to The People's Pharmacy, one of my favorite shows, and on it they had a doctor, David Hanscom. He works at the Swedish hospital, or Swedish Medical Institute in Seattle, Washington. And he used the word repent. He was talking about pain. And in particular, he's a neurosurgeon. He does a lot of back surgery, but he found most of the people, vast majority of the people he did surgery on, it didn't take care of their pain. So he said the source of pain has to be somewhere else. And his research, and it says the research of neuroscientists, tell us that the problem with pain, especially chronic pain, even when the thing that was hurting, like an arm could be cut off, but it can still hurt. The reason is a pathway, he called it a pathway. The pain pathway is permanent going to our brain. It's there all the time. What aggravates it? Anxiety and anger. What do we get anxious about? The things that we cannot control, right? What do we get angry about? The things that we cannot control. Or often the people we cannot control. There are a lot of things in your life out of control that you cannot control. There are a few in mine. How do we respond? So, Dr. Hanscom said that he's learned that if you repent, you can begin to build new pathways. So when he has people come to him, he first makes sure they get a good night's sleep, which is easier said than done. But then he teaches them steps. He's got 5 different steps to take. And one of those steps is repenting. And he said, all the negative feelings, the anxiety and the anger that we have pent up in ourselves are often over things that we cannot control, and therefore we've responded to them in a wrong way. So he tells people to write for 3 to 5 minutes every day. Write everything that's negative in your life. Write for 3 to 5 minutes a day. And repentance comes when you take that sheet of paper that you've written on, all the negative things, all the things you're angry about, and you tear it up. So tear it up and get rid of it. He said, you can't use the shredder, you have to tear it up. You cannot wad it up and throw it away, you have to tear it up. And he says you need to do this every day. He himself has dealt with chronic pain, and he said every once in a while his life gets out of joint, and he realizes he hasn't been repenting. Well, when John says to repent, he wants us to get rid of all those things that aggravate us. And when people asked him in the Gospel of Luke, when they asked him, well, okay, I repent. What now should I do? He talks about all the things that seem to be out of people's control. Respond to them in the right way. Somebody comes by and asks you for a coat. It's usually a military person who's going to take it anyway. Give him your cloak also. Why? Don't respond in anger. Wind up responding. Don't respond in a way that just brings junk into your life and into your world. You want to prepare your heart for the coming of Jesus. Repent. Make straight those roads into your life, into your heart. I'm going to end with a story. We want to have clean hearts because God is anxious, just like he was anxious to come to the people of Israel, build that road in the wilderness. He is anxious to come to us. I read a story recently about a man who was in World War II, and he was 22 years old, and he was in charge of a troop of men who were 17 and 18. And he thought, he felt that he was decades older than them because he had seen so much in the war. And now he was in charge of them, in charge of their lives, and he was a medic on top of it. And he was given orders to go to a farm and have his men sleep in the granary that night, unheated German winter. And they were all in the granary, and he thought he needed to get away, so when the farmer drove his truck in, he knew it would be warm under the truck with the engine sending some heat down, so he went and laid under the truck until the heat dissipated, and then he had to go back into his in the granary with his troop. As he laid under that truck, he thought about his life and how he had become an atheist. He had given up on God. He had seen so much in this war, so much pain, heartache, violence, ugliness. In his mind, there was no God. He went back in the granary, and he found two of his men were missing. And he found out that they had gone to the farmer's house to see if the farmer had a couple bottles of wine. So he thought, well, I better go get them. So he started going and met the men on the way back, and they did not have wine, but they said, the farmer's daughter, she's really sick. She needs your help. She needs some kind of help. So the man was a medic, and he says, okay, I'll go and see. So he goes and finds out she's not sick. She was pregnant, and she was in labor, having a very difficult labor. He did whatever he needed to do, and soon a baby was born. And he took off his own dirty jacket lined with Sherpa, laid the baby in it, wrapped the baby up to keep the baby warm, and sat by the fire in this unheated farmhouse, a little itty-bitty fire, he said, trying to keep the baby warm. And he felt tears going down his eyes because for the first time in a long time, when that baby needed so desperately to be born, he prayed to God, oh, dear God, he prayed desperately to God, dear God, please let this baby be born. And now his eyes were filled with tears because he realized he could believe again. God desperately wants to come to us. He wants us to do some house cleaning. Amen.
Please rise and sing as we share our tithes and offerings.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we pray that you prepare our hearts and come and renew your church, that we be a herald of glad tidings, announcing the good news that you are drawing near. Lord, in your mercy, we pray that you prepare our hearts and come and bring your peace. Strengthen all who strive for peace to end conflict and war. On this Pearl Harbor Remembrance Day, we recount the sacrifice of those who died in the attack, and help us, in their honor, to be devoted to justice and peace, even as we pray for peace and healing of the racial division in our country, and an end to ethnic cleansing in the Middle East nations, and war throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy, prepare our hearts, gracious God, and renew your creation. Recreate wilderness and desert terrains, mountains and plains, fields fallow in winter, and for fruitful vegetation during these summer days in the southern hemisphere. Lord, in your mercy, prepare our hearts, gracious God, and come with your healing. Bring your healing to those who are weighed down with sickness, especially Teresa Baumgartner, Doris Embertson, Tiffany Giles, Karen Groves, Dixie Hicks, Jim Lampe, Betty Lassant, Dorothy Lokensgaard, Karen Lotion, Rose McGiles, Darlene McLaughlin, Pat Morrison, Ron Murhammer, Suzanne Noe, Trish Norberg, Grant Reed, Jim Runyon, Carolyn Sick, Mary Thomas, Janice Trotter, David Ugla, and Evie Weir. Are there any others? Gracious Heavenly Father, we give thanks for many things in life. Today we give thanks especially for the Boyd family, that Nolia and Zoe Boyd had their adoption finalized. And we give thanks for your holy ones who faithfully prepared the way of the Lord. We pray that you comfort the grieving, especially the family and friends of Nancy Michael and of Cody Huber. Lord, in your mercy.
Only did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nation? Did you know that your baby boy was heaven's perfect love? And this sleeping child you're holding is a great honor. Oh, Mary, did you know?
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Holy God, the beginning and the end, our salvation and our hope. At this end of the ages, we thank you for your Son, who came to bring us your love and to heal all the suffering world. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his life, death, and resurrection, we await his coming again in righteousness and peace. Send your Spirit on us and on this bread and wine we share. Strengthen our faith, increase our hope, and bring to birth the justice and joy of your Son who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. All is ready. Our Lord invites us. Please come. You may be seated. Thank you. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, through the gifts of his body and blood, strengthen, keep, and unite us now and forever. Amen. Gracious Heavenly Father, we do pray that you help us prepare our hearts. Send your help. And then send us out, filled with your love, to share that love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Receive this benediction. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the grace that sustains every breath we take, the love of God that gives us courage and strength, and the abiding presence of the Holy Spirit that fills our hearts with comfort and peace, be with you and all those you care about, now and forever. Amen.
Let the earth rejoice, heaven comes to you.
Go in peace to serve the Lord.
Glory to